No, I think officially was the next speaker. So the next speaker is from robotic industry, Marak Salawaski. He's a robotic expert and entrepreneur. He has 15 years experience in the industry.
Hello everybody, my name is Marek Sadowski, and I'm very privileged to be able to speak in front of you. Especially it's a Saturday. So I will talk about robot dogs and swarm of robots. I brought one of the dogs over here. It's a large machine, 60 pounds. Weight. I used to call it 13 kilograms. As you can guess from my San Franciscan accent, I'm from Eastern Europe, from Poland, and I came here to bring my startup and find new partners. And this robot now is still operated because it takes some time, unfortunately, still to make it autonomous. So we're just moving over here so you can. So you can observe each other, the audience and the robot. If you happen to find the robot in front of you sometime in the future, usually they have the button. It's a kill switch. So if you press the button, the robot's supposed not to move away. So you never know with this robot. So. And so let me go with the introduction. So we are going to talk about robot dogs and the group of robot dogs and the system that is going to work for these robot dogs. But let me tell you something about myself. So my name is Marek Sadowski, and I was working here in Silicon Valley back in 99. And the picture shows me with more hair. I was in NASA very happy. It was 99. We were working on the Mars mission program. I was doing a virtual reality system to control robots on Mars, and it was awesome job, and I got this bug. I call it robotics bug, or robotics flu. I couldn't stop thinking about the robots since then. However, in order to survive and manage my living, I was working as IT specialist and IT architect for large international corporations like HP, IBM. I was working even in, for me it was even, because I'm coming from Europe, so in Japan, so for NTT. And I was always doing the research on big data, on cloud systems, even though they were not called at that time cloud systems. However, the bug and robotics flu stayed with me, so in 2004 I decided to start a broad project and create a swarm system. The swarm, that means a group of robot system to control robots. And we created robots for service, not robots for leisure. So so in such a way we could survive. And I'm happy to bring here a company that is almost 12 years old. So what do we do? The first thing we have to share with the with our prospects is our system to control robots. We call it fleet, from a fleet of robots. And we can manage from one console several robots. And this system was delivered thanks to the project from European Union. We were funded about $1 or $2 million to deliver this project. The project finished in 2013. Now we are looking for the partner to make it commercial. We base our system on so-called autonomy. And this autonomy, that means robots can drive by themselves. They have kind of a spirit or a ghost inside that drives them around. So so it's very important for us to have something like this in a robot. Because you don't want to look at the robot anytime later after setup. So robot is going by itself. It cleans. it protects and recharges by itself. So all the functions are done by the robot. Next part, on the course of the project, we realized that there are not everybody believes in the ghosts or even swarm of ghosts. So we had to come up with the real products. And we have created several products. This one, electric dog, is one of the offsprings of showing off to the public that there is a spirit of the robots, and there is a swarm system that can control this spirit, and in such a way, other robots. So we have deployed several products, and we sold them to several institutions, like domestic robots and industrial robots and military robots. And finally, sometimes we don't have enough projects to keep our team busy, so we are open to support other institutions to create robots on demand. So you can do project with us. And who are we? We are a team of about 20 engineers, located primarily in Poland, in the European Union. And we work from Europe. And because of our location, Eastern Europe, our usage of us is very well balanced. So we call ourselves as Bangalore for robotics. So it's like outsourcing for robotics. And we have good experience working for various customers and working with various customers. Starting with my experience, NASA, IBM, HP, our partners worked for Raytheon, GE, Exponent, local consulting company, and so on. Who are our advisors? So the most important advisor is Mark Ivanovsky, former Raiders NFL player. He exited two startups, and both of them were connected with technology. One of them was a submarine startup. He was doing robots, underwater robots. And he exited this company to Raytheon. And the other person who is helping me out is Bob Christopher, who created a small robot-like pet. It was a dinosaur. The company was called Ugobi, and the robot was called itself Plio. He had a global rollout of the company. Unfortunately, due to the recession back in 2009, he had to close the company. And just recently, he helped with the huge success of the Jibo, a small company from Massachusetts that got invested $25 million for the development of the home assistive robot. And finally, we have a person who is helping me out from the side of the energy sector, Professor Monkash from U.S. Polish Trade Council, who works for the Stanford University, and he consults a lot of energy projects globally. So these are my advisors, and we deliver services in USA and Europe. We can adapt existing platform that is either teleoperated or manually operated to become a robot. So it's and it takes us just 3 to 6 months. And what is the most intriguing is that the robots that we create out of the existing products are almost the same bill of material, because already a lot of products has a lot of chips on board. So we just add very cheap products to make robots autonomous. So that means sensors for various various situations. And we provide the customers with know-how transfer, bill of material, production setup, tooling. And what is very important, I came over here to Silicon Valley to look for partnerships and global partnerships as well. So I'm open for partnership with Asia. In my opinion, the most innovative country is China. And why is that? Because China is able to adopt new technologies very quickly. Then comes States, and Silicon Valley is the leading place for adoption of the new technologies. And unfortunately for me, but it comes from my experience, 10-year experience gave me understanding that Europe is lagging very much behind. We in Europe are very conservative. We don't believe in entrepreneurship. We rather consume what was done in Silicon Valley or China. So what I have done up to date, we have, in April, I just closed one of the projects for autonomous robot here in Silicon Valley. But before that, I deployed a Spirit, which is the autonomy module for the robot boat. So it's a drone that's driving on the lakes or bays. I have sold a home robot vacuum, like Roomba or Kingvats back in China, to a very large European producer. And I have inserted an inspection and cleaning robot for the double floors that they are being used for the data centers. And not only that, I'm taking part in the competitions, and this is part of my talk today, in which I show the robots that are doing reconnaissance, and they are doing not only reconnaissance but also patrol. So the electronic dog that is not supervised goes by itself and looks for the objects of interest. And we got the best scientific solution competing against the iRobot, among others. iRobot was having the same amount of the points, but they were using joystick. So that is the difference. Our robots are doing it by themselves. And last year, in a military LRO competition in Europe, we won first place for the autonomous transportation out the doors. That means the robot was moving between two points by itself autonomously. And so we started global commercialization. We came here to Silicon Valley. We have two offices, one in Palo Alto. The other office is in San Francisco. But our R&D office is based in Eastern Europe. As I told you, we have the model like a Bangalore for robotics. And we are trying to keep this model because it's very effective. And we have small scale production. It couldn't match to the large scale production in China, but it's for the 10, 100 maybe units, it's okay. So what is Fleet? Fleet is a logistics security telepresence system that can be deployed on several robots, 5 to 10 robots, and they can go around. And first of all, they can understand the environment, so they can do mapping. Then they can look for the objects of interest. And the project itself is done with help of European Union, was done with help of European Union. And the robots can collaborate with everybody, and I mean everybody with other robots. They can help themselves to extend, for example, network. The system is based on the mesh network. And we use various algorithms to manage robots. So you can have robots at first that do the mapping, and then later they will do the patrolling and looking for threats, chemical threats like carbon monoxide, methane, or other gases. They can look also for radiation. And they can recognize also objects of threats like improvised explosives. So this system is able to navigate several robots, dispatch the task. The robots are communicating, and they are dividing the task among themselves. And how I come up with the specification? So we took part in several competitions. One of them was Magic 2010 in Australia. For the autonomous robots and controlling of the group of robots, we took part in the European competitions, and so first of all, what we do, we make the robots to understand the objective, so search for the object that they are going to look for in the algorithm. Then we select the area in which robots are going to drive, or the points between which they are going to shuttle. And then the robots, they go, they approach. And And when they are in the area, they will scan the area. They will do it constantly. And for that, for the successful preview of the area, we got the main prize, the best scientific solution back in 2012 against the iRobot, as I said. And we did pretty well. So now I have a short video how the system works. So let me just try to go there. So in the beginning, you can see iRobot just finishing the task. They are running up the control station. I will increase the speed of the video, so it's a little bit long. So I will be able to. You can see. You can see the robot from iRobot, Packbot. It's military class robot that was doing the task before us. And now our robot is moving forward. It's double speed, so robot is very slow. It's the same speed as this robot over here. We are trying to make the robots now going faster. Since we got very limited very limited resources in terms of financing, we couldn't afford to create a better suited robot. But this robot has everything like the other one, except for the GPS, because we are using a global positioning system for the navigation. For localization, we are using LiDAR. So the red light over here comes from the laser that is scanning area in 2D. And over here, we have also a sensor for IMU. And I wanted to say something since we are in the building. So I had a small token, and we were talking about the Moore law, and we are going to talk about Moore law. So inside we have just a regular computer. What I'm trying to do now, I'm trying to use Edison instead of the common computer. So it's just a chip like this, and Edison board is enough to power this robot. So Moore law is working. This is the proof. So the robot is going to use the Moore, the chip like this, so computer on the chip. This is lights. So I have this Edison over here, and we are going to upgrade the machine. Not only it's going to run faster and consume less energy because of the usage of this small chip, but also it's going to last for longer. So all the benefits are over there. So this is a demo. The robot was going around, and now also we are showing how our engineer. So lady over here was she was responsible for the image recognition. So robot now is trying to find her. It's like a bull. So it can be a dog, it could be a bull. So the robot is chasing her, and so we use it for remembering the path, and it's a very simple method. It can be either something like this T-shirt. It was a very wet winter back in Poland in 2013, I guess, if I recall it. So in that time, we couldn't wear just the T-shirt. And we try to deploy this solution to let the robot to see all the points. So you will see description on the screen where the T-shirts were. So now my colleague is going to grab the mouse, and we are going to deploy the path back to the robot. So robot sees all the points, and now it's going to return. So now robot goes back on its footsteps, And so in such a way you can teach the robot without touching the robot where it should go. So doesn't if someone asks why it doesn't follow me, it doesn't recognize my suit. I should wear the. I wanted to bring my, my son who is helping me a lot. You will meet my son on the other video. So this is the video, and so let me go back to the presentation. So I will go back to my slide. So we are back to the slide, and the same system was deployed on the bot. So so the same way you can over here it's different because it looks underwater and on the water. So underwater it looks through the sonar. You can sense the objects and can work with the ideas that, that are there. And then you mark the area you scanned, and the robot is mapping the sea bottom. And the robot is going up. So it uses our fleet system, and it uses our brains for the navigation. So the other robot I have is Pi R2. Pi comes from the two things. One is Raspberry Pi that you can mount on the robot. And the other thing is the price, Pi, $314 for the robot. So maybe ring the bell. So let me go to the video. So this is our video showing just another robot vacuum. This is the platform I sold to the large European electronics producer. And here with my kids, I'm deploying the robot. But the task I'm showing here is how you can manage the robot out of the cloud. So we were talking before about security. And so my son is turning on the robot from the iPad. Robot is moving forward. I will show you how the application looks like and what is the architecture. And the robot is supposed to be more exciting for the geeks because of the cloud. But for us consumers, it's maybe just a little bit better. Doesn't hit and doesn't bump other objects, and also it doesn't and it vacuums better. We, not us, but our large electronics consumer did the tests, and it happens that this robot gets 50% more dust. So we are waiting now to license it farther with this. Company, and we are also trying to run the Kickstarter campaign for them to get the availability on the cloud. So now I'm using or leveraging Apple Watch. I don't have an Apple Watch. However, my wife gave me approval for purchase of Apple Watch, so I can maybe in the future I can show it off. So first of all, you pair the robot. The robot sends you a message. So you are double sure that you are connected, and maybe on the video you're going to see on the on my iPhone the message was sent. So now with the message sent, I'm going to reuse the IBM cloud, which is Bluemix. It's pretty cool environment because it can grow and scale with you. So because of that, I'm using it, and I'm using also NoSQL database. So in order to deploy the solution on various platforms, I'm using Mobile First, which is also IBM product. And I can use in such a way Android devices and Apple devices. And it also gives me a lot of security and integration. So I'm covered by from the security standpoint because of the Mobile First. And also I'm covered from the integration point because our team is scarce. We are looking for investment to increase the size of the team. But still, it's not enough. And so in order now to manage the device, we are using the Node-RED, which is like Node.js. It's a programming style on the cloud. And Node.js symbolized over here is symbolizing the flow. So I can add a new element like a cloud and deployment. And cloud is the database I told you. Previously we were all using SQL databases. This is no SQL database. So you use just JSON messages. So it's just like so you can turn off the robot and then you can talk to the robot easily and robot is talking. So this is the second video I had. And let's go back to the presentation. So I will explain a little bit more where we are. So so we have a robot, so we can pair from, for example, from Apple Watch. Then we can start using the robot, and the robot can, for example, send a picture to us. And then next thing is connection to the various devices. So I'm what I'm using mobile first from IBM, and I'm using Bluemix from IBM. This is free of charge for developers, for startups, and for 30 days it's free of charge for everybody. So, so because of that, it's the platform I'm leveraging, which is Node.red. So I can push the information from the IoT device, which is a robot, what is happening. And now I can manage several robots from this console. And robots, after hitting docking, it starts to dock. And next step of the robot is going to be really self-efficient, so it's going to clean itself. Now I am responsible for cleaning, and that's all to be done. So other projects we are doing, for example, we take part in bidding for military ultralight backpack EOD robots. They are end of disposal robots. So so these are the things our team is capable of doing. And next year, first half, we are trying to deploy the project of the autonomous cleaning machine for large spaces, for the office spaces and for department stores. And this project is funded by European Union. It's about $2 million. We are at the end of the end phase of the project. And autonomy itself, as I told you, it's almost the same autonomy for the larger devices like this. For very large, we also have a platform of like 600 pounds. And we can scale it down to the vacuum cleaner. So you can deploy it on various devices. You come up with the idea, I will produce it for you. So, how everything is managed. So if you have an interface for mobile phone, this interface is talking to the cloud. The cloud of choice for me was IBM Bluemix. And from IBM Bluemix, I'm talking to all the robots. And all the robots are talking to the cloud itself. So they need to have either modem, Wi-Fi connection, or any way to communicate with the internet. And in such a way, our robots are like Internet of Things, but moving Internet of Things. And they can be used for various tasks. So I told you about outsourcing. Our team is outsourcing various projects, and we are happy to help with that. And new wave comes with the advanced manufacturing. So our projects are also capable of doing that and helping for logistic and monitoring. So what we do, we work closely with local Palo Alto Electric Power Research Institute. I'm trying to deploy a project. We are also working with South Africa mining company. They're trying to use our robots for protection. And electronic docks come from this slide because we thought it's the closest thing we can get about the robots and the docks. So the problem is that there are a lot of tasks being done routinely. There's no skill needed. You just need a dog, or maybe cleaning machine, or maybe forklift. So we can change that to use the robot, so optimize that. And and teach our team to be more efficient, manage several roles instead of growing the team. There is a huge competition here in Silicon Valley and globally. So what we differentiate from them, we are having robots, and we have competency in cleaning, inspection, and security, as well as logistic and transport tasks, indoors and outdoors. And, we have superior autonomy based on the laser. A lot of companies are not having that. So just confirming that we are here to make partnerships, if you look for that. And with that, I would like to finish. So thank you very much for attention. I'm really privileged to be able to speak in front of you. And my dog is over here as well, very happy. Doesn't speak, but it is. So thank you very much.
So we do have time to take your questions. Please stand by the microphone.
Hi, my name's Jason Xu. I'm from Sycamore Venture. So I'm very interested in the security side of the dogs. And so the question is really, so when you have threats entering the boundary of your guarded area, besides taking photos and information, can the robot arm itself, or any other method you can use to deter the threat?
So imagine the intruder is a squirrel. I have some people from Santa Clara.
It's a person.
Which person is the same. So okay. So if we have a squirrel that comes over there, we can use the water gun. If it's not enough, we can use the sound. And if it's not enough, I have colleagues from military that are telling me what I can use on top of the road.
So but the question is, if someone enter the trespass onto the public, when they see the robotics, they can destroy it once they lost all the vehicles, right?
That's very correct. Yeah, that's true. And in a home situation, you would know that something happened to the robot, because the robot is not present anymore on the network. And with the dog, you would not hear the bark anymore. With this guy, you would notice immediately on all the systems that the node is not present, so you would have the alert everywhere you are.
So my question is, before the dog dies, or before the robotic dies, would they take a picture of the intruder and
yes.
Send to the crowd?
Yeah, this is the easiest way. So it takes the picture, uploads it to the cloud. We have large cloud of IBM, so that they would be happy to pay if you pay them for storing the images. Yeah. So it's a very good question. A lot of people are asking me about that. They are also asking what to do in order to not remove the robot with the burglar. So burglar can come and bring the robot with them. So there is also a way how we can protect that. I hope that answered the question.
Okay.
I'm open for further discussion later.
I have a question. How long do you think this will sell for the customer? Personally, I love it. I'm just not sure if I can afford it.
Yeah. So at the moment, this platform is the prototype. Prototypes are always very expensive. We are trying to decrease the price to about $1,000. So we could have a robot that is going around our property for $1,000. This is with Edison, the chip I showed you. It's becoming very very, very affordable. Because at the moment, the most expensive parts are battery, engines, the motors inside, and the computer. So computer is now $100, and so it's getting really cheap.
Very good.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. And if you're interested in talking to more, please stay after the conference, and we'll